I'm gonna try this mic. Man, that sounds good. We on the board are overwhelmed by all your presence today. It's really something. I'm a charter member of this organization. I was at the original meeting at the Musicians Hall in Renton in 1975, was it, sir? And gosh, I'd say up until the mid-80s or the 80s, the meetings were all like this with overflow people. And it's really, I don't know, I'm almost crying. Thank you so much. I'd ask you to consider becoming members, and we can have more good times like this. So, and thank Bert for allowing us to do this. He's on. Calling all former band members, people who have played with Bert, I'd ask them to stand up so that they will be easier to identify. I know Dave Brown has donated his time today, as has John Goodrich. Dave came from Spokane. John Goodrich came especially from Montana. Appreciate it. Kevin Johnston over there has been playing with Bert pretty regularly. Pretty regularly, and he's here. And James Wall is here. I'm not getting much cooperation with people standing up. Dave Loomis is here. He's standing, still on his first beer. Oh, he's he says he's slipping. Terry Rogers, who will be playing for us in a couple of months, has sat in. Jerry Green and Jim Armstrong came all the way from Vancouver. I think that deserves a special round of applause. And Mr. Hilliard over there, he's been playing with the band. Who else needs to be? Al Luxuret? Where? George Ulrich? Steve Wright, of course. Well, Steve is, yes, that's true. Steve was an announced member. Al Rustad, yes. Stand up. There's a band leader. Anyway, thank you all for coming. Oh, Bob Jackson. Whoa, Bob Jackson. There's cake back there, and anybody that hasn't yet partaken, please do. We don't have a place for it after today. I would encourage you to, we've only got one set to track down the guest book, and give your regards to Bert. Like I say, you may have to track it down because I've been trying to pass it around. Okay. We're going to have just one speech from an important person, and that is Tom Jacobus. So if we could have a little bit of quietude to listen to what Tom has to say, because Tom is, I think, about the longest. But he and Bert's friendship goes back farther probably than anyone else here. And back to when they were kids in California, just learning how to play jazz. And Tom's gonna tell us a little bit about that period and thereafter, because they went to school in Oregon, at the University of Oregon together. So they've been together since the beginning. Tom? Now you're talking. Thank you very much. Nobody knows Bert Barr like I know Bert Barr. We met at McKinley Elementary School in Vallejo, California, around 1957 or 58. Initially, he was a friend of my brother's, as they were both 2 years ahead of me in school. But Bert and I shared something they did not, music and trumpet. We became instant friends and spent some time together after school. Bert never met his dad, as he had passed away before Bert was born. His first male role model was his uncle, Smitty, a rousing character who always kept us in stitches. Turns out he was quite the pool shark as well. Do you remember the days of record stores? You would enter the rows of LPs, and there were listening booths and store copies you could check out of various albums before making your final selection. This was Graf's music in Vallejo. And Uncle Smitty was an employee. Well, Smitty was a huge Firehouse 5 plus 2 fan and brought home the copies no longer deemed usable. Bert was introduced to these recordings pretty early on and was playing along with them as soon as he acquired the necessary technique on his trumpet. By high school, he was ready to start his first band. He found some like-minded musicians in the high school band, and he launched. Rehearsing upstairs of Graf's music in the evenings and or weekends, Bert had seen a bass and snare drum in my basement that belonged to my dad's Mighty Wurlitzer pipe organ. And in typical Bert style, that meant I could be the drummer he needed. With Dad's permission and help, we painted the bass drum bright red, added a new head or two, bought some needed hardware and stands, and now I am a drummer. No matter, I didn't have a clue what to do. Years later, Bert got me again when he said, quote, and this is an absolute true story, "You're the only guy I know that even likes Turk Murphy, so you're taking up the trombone." Thank you. That little band reared some exceptional musicians. Besides Bert, a wonderful clarinet, tenor sax, and banjo player named Jerry McKinty was in that band. Jerry later married Jan Sutherland, the singer in the Mersey-Sippi jazz band from England. I don't know if any of you ever were Sacramento Jubilee attendees back in the early years, but that band often came to the States, and darn if Jerry didn't end up marrying her years later. Another remarkable musician from that first band was Mark Kronoski, who played alto mostly, but was an amazing piano player. His parents loved Jelly Roll Morton, and Mark would sit at the keyboard and rattle off most of Morton's solos and Bix's In a Mist. Mark was awarded one of the Vallejo High School's most coveted scholarships his senior year. His passion, sadly, did not remain in our kind of music, and we have all lost track of him since. Was another wonderful musician that played with us often those days. His name is Jim Snook. He was a trombone and later a fine tuba player in the Sacramento area. And I'm on Facebook with him every once in a while. And all five of us, now the five would be myself, Bert, Jerry McKenzie, Jim Snook, and Mark Kronowski are all on this album that's available right over here. Are they just for the taking? Yeah. Every one of those musicians is on the Chicago Ramblers album. They're re-recorded. Yeah, there it is. For Ted Schaefer's Merrymakers label. So, if you have any interest, there's some unbelievably rare tunes on there. That band played at the local Shakey's Pizza Parlor on Sunday evenings with our parents' rousing enthusiasm for several years, and Shakey's sponsored us in the Vallejo 4th of July parade. I'll never forget us building the float for the parade, and his Uncle Smitty never laid a finger to help us, sat in the window ledge up above them. We're in the driveway putting this thing together. And with his salty language, he kept us absolutely in, you know, hilarious stitches. And you know what? Everything he told us, he was absolutely, he helped us build that. It was amazing. What a nut he was. In 1964, I enrolled at the University of Oregon to pursue a football career, and Bert decided it was time for him to get his education. So he started at Vallejo Community College. This is where he met possibly the biggest influence in his life, Mr. Dave Froelich, the choir and music theory instructor. Mr. Froelich was an amazing teacher, musician, and friend to all his students. Bert learned more at Vallejo Community College in his 2 years of theory than I even remotely learned at Oregon. And let's just say it was more my fault, maybe. But Bert helped me to learn practical use of music theory later. So he taught me the real ins and outs of how it works practically when you got the horn in front of your face. Upon finishing his 2 years of community college, Bert enrolled at Oregon to finish up his degree, and would have done so if the Vietnam War hadn't interfered. In the meantime, he married a Seattle girl, and by the way, the offspring of that marriage was here. Is he still here? There he is, right there. That's Brian Barr. Bert's first wife, first marriage, is his son. He grew up with my two children. They were very friendly, and they saw each other quite often up in Bellevue, your home there. Brian, I hate to tell you this, but later on I became Bert's best man for the second time. That's a distinction, probably not a folks. That's correct. Bert enlisted in the Army Band at Fort Lewis and spent a tour of duty in Vietnam, where he started a Dixieland band. This is so typical. He started a Dixieland band, of course, to perform at events, but mostly to stay in the air-conditioned music hut and getting out of KP duty. And you'll love this. He called that band, correct me if I'm wrong, the Saigon Hot Rats. Now there's a band name for it. After his service, he quickly finished up at Oregon and put his roots down in Bellevue, where he promptly started his first version of the Uptown Lowdown Jazz Band. He also went to work for Tom Hobbs Holiday Music, selling pianos mostly. Now we all know Dave Hobo, and I've got a great story to impart about Dave. Dave was also a Hobbs employee, and there came a time when they worked together at the store in Bellevue. And Bert apparently was asking him. He heard Dave playing a guitar, I guess. And said, "Do you ever play banjo?" "Yeah, I know." So he said, "Well, take it up. There's one on the wall." Well, 6 weeks later, he asked Bert again. Bert asked him, Dave again, "Have you done anything with that banjo?" "No." "Well, I've got a gig for you on Saturday." So Bert strikes again, and Holo learned, I guess, one major, one minor, a diminished, and whatever. And then he cranked all those one at a time up and down the neck and got through the gig. Dave eventually became quite proficient on the guitar. Later, there was another young man that worked for Bert and at the Holiday Music in Bellevue. He was a banjo instructor. Guitar instructor. And he taught evenings at the store. And the next time Bert was in need of a banjo player, he asked Jeff Weissman. How do you remember Jeff Weissman? Yeah. He was my first banjo player when I started the Evergreen Classic. And so he got the same treatment. Learn it. For a guitar player to learn tenor fingerings, as I understand it, is not the easiest. So Jeff got the same treatment. Bert asked me to move to Seattle to join the Uptown Lowdown in 1979. I was ready for a change, so I accepted. And I'm still here 40 years later. No regrets, and nothing but appreciation for everything that Bert Barr did for me in my life.
To write articles for our jazz newsletter. Tom said a whole lot, but I've found out that that's really just the tip of the iceberg of what Bert has done for jazz music here in Seattle and the Pacific Northwest. And sometimes the time comes to pay the piper, and your time has come, Bert. We want to congratulate ourselves because we're associated with you. And thank you so very much. And as a small token of our appreciation, we want to give you a gift. This is hopefully will supplement your Amazon passion. And here is a packet of the letters that we received for you. All of which are posted back there. And one of your past musicians, who also sent a letter, has bestowed upon Carol Johnston the duty of giving you a piece of his personal artwork. And Carol can make that presentation here.
Well, Bertram played with the Uptown Lowdown, apparently, in 1978. And so, look there. So I've been passing it around to several other people because I don't recognize some of the plays. I recognize Susan Spear, and then Bert's next to her. And we'll pass this around while they're playing. And then right behind there, in playing tuba, we got Sal Smith suggested. But it turns out it's Tom Jacobus. I don't know if you even remember some of these people, but MJ Wood. Yes, and something like that. And then on drums was the infamous Stephen Joseph. Behind that is a trombone player, Bertram. on piano, and you don't recognize her too well, she says, oh, that's when they have brown hair, it's Rosemary. And then George Goldsberry, one of our all favorites, you know, clarinet player. And on banjo, we kept asking so many people about all kinds of names, you know, and Brad Owen, I don't even remember him, do you? Can you name all your banjo players that you had? Well, he wasn't around in 78. Obviously, you're the best one. But anyway, it's Dave Holo when he played banjo when they were telling that story. So this is going to you, but can I show this to other people? I will go do that. You know, sorry. Yeah. Anyway, and they were very sorry to come. They moved to Sacramento. They said the best thing about Thanksgiving, that they were only 5 minutes away from their son, who lives down there, you know, to go home and travel. But nevertheless, and they were near the fires. So I hope to see it.
Yeah, Bert Bertram really, he called me a couple of times and he wanted to come up, but his son went on vacation and somebody needed to feed the farm animals. So good old dad had to go ahead and do that. So I guess the father-son relationship trumps the band members. Anyway, that really concludes things except for the music. Please stick around. We're going to have a boatload of musicians on the stage. And let's give Bert a hand.
Speechless after all that. But it's been a great afternoon. I'm glad you did it. And thank you very much.
Yeah, please track down the sign-in book and give a note.
Thank you. the best of people. He's not all the best. Well, he is.
It has to do with, in June of 1925, Dinah Shore was born Fanny Rose Shore. She sang the song Dinah a number of times, and then there was a disc jockey who couldn't remember her name, so he called her that Dinah girl. That's what happened when her name was changed from Fanny Rose to Dinah. She's Dinah Shore because the disc jockey couldn't remember her name. So we're going to do Dinah. Talking about it. This is another one of those cases where we don't know what they're going to do up there.
Thank you.
from a couple, Bill and Claire Rink from Texas. Every time they came to a festival, they would ask for the West Texas Blues. And I just got an email from her, and she said, record it today. Thanks, Bill and Claire. Well, we're going to play it, whether it gets recorded or not, we hope. Mississippi Delta.
shelter of the vine. Fruits of cotton, all around me. Voices singing, sweet and low. Lord, I'm lucky that you found me where the muddy Mississippi waters flow. I'm sitting on my head, listening to the nightingale.
Thank you. her thought process up. So he wrote a song called Something for Annie. Well, I happen to have a sister. Annie, stand up. She's my little sister, and she's younger than me. Annie, right, stand up. We're going to play this for Annie. As the Church Murphy wrote for that other lady, and I'm dedicating to my sister.
Mom, she's gone.
Maple, stand up. Who's Annie?
Thank you.
21, he was on one of the cruise ships down here in Puget Sound, and he was listening to Uptown Lowdown, and he wanted very much to play with the band. But Bert said no. And I said, oh, come on, he's just a kid. Let him come up on the stage. So Bert said, all right, he wants to play with the band, he's going to have to play what we want. So he called a very difficult tune that nobody knew, except Loomis knew it, and he played it. Okay, now let's see, we have another tune here called, this next tune was a tune that started because Louis Armstrong was singing this song, and while he was singing this song, he dropped his word sheet. And so he didn't have any words, so he kind of started scatting, just singing syllables that didn't mean anything. And Andy Hall did a great contribution on that. Jeezy Jeezy.
He's going to get a shirt on Iowa, and they have to drive back to Iowa.
Thank you. Yes, I got the heebie-jeebie.
Thank you.
Warhorse. In music language, a warhorse means everybody knows the song and everybody can play it. So we're going to do that because we have a nice group of people here. It's going to call High Society. And you are all High Society. Thank you for being here.
Tractor rings a bell, he comes to take stuff the shelf. There's a goose gift that everything's in hock, and your baby doesn't answer when you knock. There's a goose gift set, there's a dapper trap friend, there's a young number stepping on the clock. There's a goose gift in crime, make him don't move and die, and any afterwards against him in his will. There's a goose gift whistles with a whack with the missus on the horse go home. Or I know. Well, the goose gift stop, pick a hop, take a shiver, or the goose gift you want to go to end it in a river, or the goose gift not as sweet it is to me.
He was just a great, great member. So this song was presented, he used to sing this song, it's called Radio. Well, when he left the band because of physical problems, Art took it over. So Art's going to sing Radio for you. And all the musicians are here. get yourself up on the stand because we're going to have a grand finale and play the Big Bear Stomp. I have to tell you this, I've been dealing with Bert's illness, and I can hear every tune he plays is a little bit stronger on his chops. Thanks to you for contributing to his recovery. Thank you so much.
Thank you. all of you. I'm going to leave it up to John, ready to go.
No, you're fine.
Yourself, Rose.
And the pianist and one of the band leaders, Rose. Thank you all. Oh, yeah, if you can help us with busing tables, we'd appreciate it. Thank you.